The idea of governance is something that touches each and every entity. All the actions undertaken by human beings through any mechanism, be it government, corporate or non-profit directly, impact the existence of life on Earth. If we talk about the management and commerce domains, corporate governance is something that takes prominence. However, commerce thrives on performance which is measurable. To measure performance more objectively, annual reports are prepared every year. This report gives us an idea on how well the shareholders and the management have utilized the resources available to business entity. But the traditional annual report failed to bridge the information gap between capital employed and value created over time. Therefore, the concept of integrated reporting gained prominence. An integrated report is a concise communication about how an organization's strategy, governance, performance, and prospects. So, with this background, it's a privilege to have Shri Amitava Banerjee with us today. He is a qualified company secretary, law graduate, MCOM, and holds a diploma in business law from NUJS, Kolkata, with a more than a decade of industry experience. He is also active in academics as a guest faculty at our university, IIT Delhi, BIMTech, and is an adjunct faculty with the Tezpur University, Assam. He has published books and articles on various themes in the domain of corporate governance and Companies Act. Today, our discussion with him will be on integrated reporting, which is an exciting and emerging aspect of governance. So let's move on with our discussion. Mr. Banerjee, welcome. What are the basics of conventional reporting?
I'll explain. The primary feature of conventional reporting is that the same is rule-based. There are certain governing rules like the Companies Act 2013, accounting standards of ICAI, the Income Tax Act, and other statutes like the MSME Act, the Small Scales Act, which define the reporting norms for the financial statements. Further, time frame is for one financial year, which is 12 months only. Hence, the data is only for a fixed period, which is on 31st of March. The other extended part is the director's report, which is when combined with the financial statements make up the annual convention of annual report. This is then shared with the shareholders. The intent is very noble because the financial statements gives you the figures and the directors being in charge of management explain the implication of those figures. However, for a listed company, a corporate governance report and a management and discussion analysis report, which is called a MNDA report, as well as a sustainability report, is also furnished with the financial statements. I really like the definition of annual report given by the US Securities Exchange Commission, because what happens is you will not find a definition of an annual report in any of the Indian statutes. The annual report, as defined by the US Securities Exchange, says it is a state of affairs of the company, including an opening letter from the chief executive officer. This is one. Second is, it is a financial data. Third, results of operation. Fourth, market segment information. Fifth, new product plans, subsidiary activities, and research and development activities on future programs. Reporting companies must send annual reports to their shareholders when they hold their annual general meeting. So it's very simple. A definition of annual report tells you that it is a letter from the CEO and is giving you all the information regarding financial data, operations, and the future programs.
So then please tell us, how are conventional reports different from integrated reports?
In case of a conventional report, We can, you know, summarize the differences in form of a slide, I would say, because there are typical categories of differences. I'll explain. So, we can summarize the difference between the two, a conventional report and an integrated report, based on certain parameters. Number one, financial aspects covered. In addition to financial and environmental and social governance aspects, covers six capitals in case of integrated reporting, whereas financial reporting gives you only financial aspects. Second, integrated reporting focuses on your past, present and future, whereas financial reporting is only talking about your past and present financials. Third, a financial reporting only takes into account 1 year or one financial year, whereas integrated reporting takes into account your short, medium and long term periods. The other part, narrow transactional disclosures are only given in the financial reporting, whereas in integrated reporting, all disclosures are given with greater transparency. Next, our financial reporting is all rule based. Like we talked earlier, it is based on Companies Act, ICAI's accounting standards, MSME Act, whereas integrated reporting is a responsive framework. It is not rule based. Financial reporting is lengthy and complex. Integrated reporting is concise and comprehensive. Lastly, financial reporting is mostly printed, but integrated reporting is mostly technology based. Hence, it is not linear. It does not define anything, but it is something which helps you in decision making.
Then what is the need for integrated reporting?
Well, the root of integrated reporting can be traced back to the principles laid down by the International Organization of Securities Commission. It's called IOSCO. IOSCO is an international body that brings together world's securities regulators and is recognized as the global standard setter for securities sector. IOSCO develops and implements and promotes adherence to internationally recognized standards for securities regulation. IOSCO's principle 16 state there should be full, accurate and timely disclosures of financial results, risks and information that is material to investors for making decisions. Now, let's look at some of the references by SEBI. You will notice that the word material is used along with investor. Hence, the word material has to be decided by the investor, but he still needs some clarity on what exactly does it mean, right? So, I'll explain again. SEBI has also used the word material. So, what is material information? Let's take an example. It is about a public issue wherein SEBI says the offer document must contain all material disclosures which are necessary for the subscribers of debt securities to take an informed investment decision. Other example, I'll go to SEBI ICDR Schedule 7. Which states such other information as is material and appropriate to enable investors to make an investment decision. Again, we come across words like informed and investment. Third, we take the example from a GRI report, that is Global Reporting Index report, which defines the report should cover aspects that reflect the organization's economic, environmental and social impacts or substantively influence the assessments and decisions of stakeholders. Now see, this is the difference between SEBI and the GRI report. SEBI is only talking of material disclosures. SEBI is only talking of information that is helping in this in decision making, whereas GRI is specifying the factors. It is saying significant economic, it is saying significant environmental and social impactful matters. Now, we get some kind of help from this, because we will understand what a material information is. So, GRI had pioneered a corporate sustainability reporting since 1997. So, we can see clearly the picture as to what material information for an investor means. So, it primarily means, number one, local communities. Next, climate strategy, operational eco-efficiency, occupational health and safety, labor practices and human rights, water-related issues, code of conduct, tax strategy, biodiversity, corporate governance, mineral waste management, human capital development, supply chain management, and that's it. So, all these factors that I have talked of are actually the parameters on which a person is making his investment decision.
So, now we know what our IR wants to change, but can you tell us a bit more how the authority IR works, who governs it, etc.?
Well, I would say that IR movement, which is integrated reporting movement, started with the formation of the International Integrated Reporting Committee, and it was in 2010, and it was formed by the princes accounting for sustainability report and the GRI initiative. In this respect, I must quote from what Prince of Wales, who founded this organization, had said. He said, "We at present are battling to meet 21st century challenges with, at best, 20th century decision making and reporting systems." Now, you see, what he is trying to say is that we are in the 21st century, but we are trying to make decisions based on data which is based on 20th century, which is old. This is the reason why integrated reporting has been brought in, to make our decisions more current. Therefore, IIRC, that is the Integrated Reporting Council or the committee, aimed to deal with challenges of overconsumption of finite natural resources, climate change, and the need to provide clean water, food, and better standards of living. Now, see their objective. This is what we are fighting for today. We are fighting with finite natural resources. We are trying to bring up our standard of living, and we are also trying to cope up with environmental issues. So, for a growing global population, the IR framework helps in tackling these issues on a more clear and comprehensive way, with information that is derived from these reports of corporates. So, the role of IIRC is to respond to the need for concise, clear and consistent yet comparable figures through the integrated reporting framework. This also reflects on the organization's strategy of being objective towards governance, business, and also being able to integrate both financial and non-financial data.